to step in the game. Here to bring the heat. Texas 22. We on the beat. Leo and BT. Hosting this show. Talking X's and O's. We letting y'all know. Texas 22. Breaking it down. Podcast got the city vibing to the sound. Special guest dropping knowledge so true. Houston Texans fam, this one's for you. Texans 22, breaking it down. Podcast got the city vibing to the sound. Special guest dropping knowledge so true. Houston Texans fam, this one's for you.
Hey guys, welcome to another episode of the Texans 22 podcast. Today our special guest is Jeremy Branham, the co-host of the Killer Bees on ESPN 97.5. What's going on, Jeremy?
Not a lot. Hanging out, enjoying all this football content. I've been doing some fantasy football drafts. These best ball drafts got all my attention. I'm doing too many. I think it might be a problem. What are you guys doing?
It's never a problem. I'm doing well. I've got my partner in crime, Leo, a.k.a. Leo Is Forgiven on Twitter. Leo, how's it going?
It's going good. Going really good.
Awesome. Well, let's get into it. So we got a bunch of stuff to talk about. The first thing that I want to talk about are all the new stuff that we have found out in camp. So let's break down the quick, easy news first. The Texans signed Fildarius Payne, released Jedon JK. We knew that was kind of going to happen because we have so many receivers at this point. It's kind of hard to keep everyone. But I really want to get into the camp updates. So here's the important stuff. Kamari Lassiter, Laremy Tunsil, Titus Howard, and Joe Mixon are back at practice. That's the best news that we have received all camp. And the biggest news is that this is the first time that we've seen the starting O-line practice together, and they're looking phenomenal. If you listen to Sean Pendergast or DJ Bieniemy or Cody Stutes on Twitter or on YouTube, they've all been talking about this insane throw by CJ Stroud that he made to Tank Dell in between two DBs. One of them was CJ Henderson. And so basically he put it right only where literally Tank Dell could get it. I wish we had a video of it. They weren't allowed to record it. But we are seeing some amazing offense here. So before I even go any further, I want to ask you, I'll start with you, Jeremy. What are some of the awesome things you're hearing in camp right now? What are you happy about, and what are some of your concerns?
I think in the backfield, you have a little bit of both. I think that you have some stuff that you could be happy about and some concern. Cam Akers has given them far more than I thought they would. Look, two preseason games. Like, he's running with the fours. What's their plan for him? It seems like they might kind of be easing him. I think he's on the roster as of now, but like RB2, probably not yet. I think they're easing him and kind of moving him in that trajectory, though. And then Damian Pierce, like, I mean, we're looking at two series here, whenever he didn't have 60% of his starting offensive line. But I thought you saw some indecisiveness that was an issue with Damian Pierce last year, like failure to, you know, hit the holes that I think he sees. I think he sees them. He's just kind of slow getting there, which is problematic. In the NFL, it's, you know, it's razor thin between being really good or not having a successful play. And then the receivers, like, the only knock on the receiver room is who's not making the team. They're so deep there. I mean, we were counting them up the other day. You might be able to name six or seven receivers before you even get to Mechie, who was a second-round pick a few years ago. So they're incredibly deep there. And we haven't seen Mixon either. I think Mixon kind of brings continuity to that running back position that'll make it fine.
Okay. Before I get to Leo, let me just say who's not practicing right now, because it's a very long list, and this is basically from Aaron Wilson. It's Jeff Okuda, Noah Brown, Tegan, Charlie Heck, Christian Harris, Ben Skoranek, Will Anderson, Danico Autry, and Tim Settle. That's the concerning part that I have. Leo, are you concerned about the amount of injuries despite the amount of positive news that we're getting out of camp?
Well, yeah, I mean, I'm honestly happy, you know, that, you know, both of our tackles are back, you know, healthy playing. I think that's kind of the best news that, you know, is that's the best news. I mean, out of everybody hurt, just the thought that, like, Titus and Tunsil are healthy is, like, makes me probably the most happy. And then on top of that, Joe Mixon being back. And I kind of feel like the rest of it, man, you know, like, kind of as it comes, you know, I feel like hopefully Will Anderson will be back. Was he practicing today? I didn't see that.
But
I,
no.
Okay, yeah. So hopefully that comes. You know, he's able to play on week one, and I mean Kamari's back. That's great. I mean, I feel like the major pieces that are gonna make the team are healthy right now, and you know that's really all you can really ask for. You know.
All right. So we had some standout plays. One of the other ones was Stingley punched the ball out of Hutch's hand for a forced fumble. That's something I love to see. I love to see plays like that. There was another play where C.J. Stroud made a huge play over the middle to Brevin Jordan. I know prior to TQ going down, there was a question whether Brevin Jordan was going to make this team, and now I think it's almost a guarantee. One of the situations that we have is that because Christian Harris is hurt, is that we don't know who's going to be the third linebacker. Henry Toa talked to press today and said he got better at tackling. Now, we'll see that on Friday, Saturday. I don't know why it says Friday there, but for the Giants game. Now, on the Steelers game, he played 9 snaps against the Steelers, 8 in the box, 1 in the slot. He had no targets, so he had a 66.5 overall PFF grade. He wasn't necessarily that noticeable, to be honest with you. He didn't make any big plays, but he also did screw up a lot. Jeremy, I'm going to start with you. How do you feel about Henry Toa essentially being the LB2 if Christian Harris can't come back week one?
Not great. He was fine as a rookie, solid as a rookie. I think he's more of a depth piece that's a solid backup. You're cool with him being a backup for you. But if he has to play 50 snaps on a Sunday, I think it puts you in a bad spot. And it's not a knock on Henry Toa. I mean, he was a mid-round draft pick. You're not expecting him to be a starter for you. You're expecting him to be a depth piece. Of all the positions on this team, that's the one area I have the biggest concern. And part of Christian Harris is a factor there because he's hurt. You know, if you had Al Shire and Harris healthy, okay, like that's really good, especially with as much as the Texans played nickel in the second half of last season. I'm curious how much 4-3 they want to play, because I think D'Amico really wants to play 4-3. I'm not sure it's the personnel for him to play a lot of 4-3. I think it's better when you look at the nickel, like who the 11 guys are out on nickel versus who they are on 4-3. But, I don't want Toa to play 50 snaps a game. He's more of a 10 to 15 snap guy for me.
All right. Leo, what do you feel about Henry Toa? Do you feel like Jeremy's right that it's okay if he's out there? And I would like you to answer the second question as well, which is, do you think that D'Amico really wants to play more 4-3? He played 78% nickel last year. Do you think that he really wants to play 4-3?
Well, I mean, the thing is, like, in reality on defense, you kind of don't have a choice. You know, the choice is made for you based on the matchup, right? So if a team is just coming out in, like, 11 personnel and they're just, you know, making these, you know, your three linebackers cover and they're not able to stop, you know, the extra receiver, then you have to play nickel, you know what I mean? So, and then, you know, vice versa. So, like, it starts off with, like, what actually you can do and where's your strength. I think any defensive coordinator, man, nobody, if a defensive coordinator could build his perfect roster, he'd be able to do everything. You know, he'd be able to have, like, you know, shit, they might even say, shit, I want to run dime. I want to have three defensive linemen that could, like, literally stop the run and pressure by themselves and, you know, run, you know, 6 or 7 DBs. So it's kind of like, you know, you want to be able to be multiple. So I do think that D'Amico does want to be able to, like, eventually. But the thing is like, where we're built at right now, you may or may not be able to, depending on the matchup, you know what I mean? So I also think, going back to Toa, I think Toa is a fine linebacker, like, you know, like you said, like, as, like, a third guy, especially with how little base is played in general today. And then those kind of, like, especially when you have two guys that can cover, like Aziz and Harris, you know, you can almost stick them at the mic and have them, you know, kind of just bludgeon people and stuff and not have to cover as much, you know. But I think, you know, man, it's hard to – I do think we need another linebacker just simply because of the depth issue. And here's the thing, like, if Harris is hurt, what happens if we're in a game and Aziz gets hurt or Toa gets hurt? Then you're sitting up there and, like, you know, you, you, like, do we feel comfortable at the fourth or potentially fifth guy? You know, those are the questions they have to ask themselves. And I think, like, the truth is like, who knows? Like, who knows if you could even find that guy that can save the season at that point? But we did last year with George Fant, you know, so I'm confident that we can. But, I mean, you know, and here's another thing, too, about linebacker in general. It's one of those positions that if the line is, like, that strong, it could really simplify their job. Like, you know, I've seen teams win Super Bowls with mid linebacker play, you know. But, I mean, we have to be dominant up front, you know what I mean? And so I guess we just got to see.
Well, this is what Lance's comment, Shep's comment. I hear everyone talking about nickel, but I feel like that might hurt us in the run game. Before I answer that question, I want to bring this up. Jalen Petrie has been watching Desmond King film from last year and film a former 49ers defensive back, Kayvon Williams, to prepare for this season. They've been putting him closer to the line of scrimmage. I think we saw that play where Hunter made a play. Was Hunter Foley, Mario Edwards, and Petrie basically just murdered the running back, right? And what I want to – my question is really to anyone that thinks that if we play too much nickel, it'll hurt us in the run game. Like Shep is saying, if we have bad linebackers, that's going to hurt us in the run game, right? So, like, if we are a nickel and we're using Petrie closer to the line of scrimmage, how much different is that from having three good linebackers, right? I mean, that's my question, because you're going to have Petrie out there, and then you have a really good defensive line. I don't know if it's going to hurt us in the run game. Jeremy, let me ask you that question first. What are your thoughts about that?
It kind of depends on what the offense is doing, you know? Like, if they're spacing you out and a bunch of 11 personnel and you're taking Petrie away from the box, now you're a number down. So it kind of depends on what the offensive outlook is, like you guys were saying. I'm curious, too, the percentage of nickel. Like, to me, it skyrocketed whenever the Texans moved on from Tavier Thomas and they brought back Des King. Like, they were playing a lot of four – like, not a lot, but they were playing more 4-3 before the pickup of Des King versus once they picked up Des King. And they pretty much went probably, like, they were playing like 95% nickel after they brought in Des King. And they were, even whenever, you know, you had 12 personnel, they were just making Des King like your third linebacker. So I am curious if they do that with Petrie, because Petrie's bigger than King. Now, is he going to be as aggressive, as tenacious? I would think so, but I want to see it. You know, I want to see what that looks like. I'm excited to see him play nickel. I was running with the ones in that spot. So I really don't. I don't think that the nickel and the 4-3 have a big difference, mainly because of the personnel with this team, though. Like, if you had a third linebacker who was equal with Christian Harris or Azeez Al-Shaair, and now you're moving to a nickel of either Petrie or King, like, that's a drop-off in terms of trying to stop the run. But if you're talking your third linebackers, Henry To'o To'o or Hewitt or Hanson, whoever, I don't think there's a drop-off there to Petrie. In fact, it's probably better to have Petrie on the field. I think that's why they went so nuts with nickel after they brought in Dez last year. It's because they didn't like what they were getting out of that third linebacker spot.
Yeah. All right. Lee, what are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, I mean, it's like, bro, nickel at 4-3, really, like, the 4-2-5 is a 4-3. You know what I mean? It's like, I feel like people are overcomplicate this so much, you know? A nickel and 4-3 is basically the same thing. Like, it just, like, when you, like, if you go and look at some of the splits we played in the Pittsburgh game, you will literally see Petrie, like, inside of the tight end, like to the inside shoulder of the tight end. And if his number was 53, you would think he was playing linebacker. So, like, got to get out of this mindset of, like, what, you know, it's a very simple game, you know. It's the same thing. Like, I'd say it's more, especially since we are even front defense, you know. We don't use the traditional nose tackle, so we're not running a five-man front and nickel, right? So it's essentially, like, it would be weirder. It would be more of a thing if, you know what I'm saying, we took a linebacker off, kept all of our defensive linemen on, and then put a DB on. But, like, to we're making a bit of bigger deal than it really is. And the thing is like, nickel is played so much now, teams are running out of 11 personnel, and teams run well out of 11 personnel. Like, you look at the Sean McVay's Rams, you look at, I mean, almost every team, you know, Like they're able to run the ball out of it. So like the thing is like you can get all great defenses can stop the run decently well out of nickel. If you can't stop the run out of nickel, then you just can't. You're just not a good defense in 2024. So that's not something I really worry about at all. You know, I know that we'll be able to stop the run with our defensive line. And it just comes down to, you know, can we cover? You know what I mean? Because, you know, that's how I look at it. You know.
Okay. So I want to talk about the upcoming game and our concerns really in one batch. So let me play the
Texans 22, breaking it down for you. Previewing the game, giving our keys to victory too. Set your speakers on fire, we're here to represent Houston Texans, get ready for the podcast today. Houston got the rhythm, we're here to break it down.
So this is the Giants versus Texans preview. It's going to be on Saturday. We should see the most amount of starting reps this game. We will be playing against a large portion of the Giants offense. Daniel Jones is going to start. Drew Lock left the game last time versus the Lions with a hip injury, so we're not going to see him. We'll probably see a bunch of Tommy DeVito. So we should see a bunch of stuff, and we all have some concerns, right? You've talked about linebacker depth, running back depth. We haven't seen Lassiter out there yet in a preseason game, only camp. And the camp news has been great. I am still a very, very big believer. So I don't. Before I say this, I want to make sure everyone understands that I'm not doubting Lassiter yet, although I want to see him in preseason. But we also been told that Damian Pierce was looking great in camp. And then we were also told that John Metchie was looking great in camp. So I want to see it for my own eyes. So Jeremy, what questions do you want to have answered during the Giants versus Texans game?
It's weird because I feel like the Texans don't have many questions. You looked like in years past, and it's like, okay, how much run is this guy going to get as a starter? Is this a battle where starting job is on the line, or is this a battle where the number two job is on the line? I mean, how many jobs are up for grabs with the Houston Texans from a starting perspective? I don't think there's one. I think you could name the 22 starters right now if they were healthy. You could name the 22 starters, I think, with ease, quite frankly. So it kind of lessens the intrigue in the preseason, which is fine. Like, I'd rather have a really good team with less intrigue that has, you know, AFC Championship, Super Bowl aspirations versus intrigue in the preseason. But in terms of questions, it's like, okay. Let's see Pierce for a second game. Was it a fluke that he didn't look as good as the training camp report? So that's something that would stick out for me. Maybe like wide receiver 5, wide receiver 6, like who's going to step up, win the job there? I think the tight end room set. Maybe like a backup interior offensive lineman, like who's going to get the final inside offensive lineman job? I think that's a question. And then who's behind, you know, Aziz and Harris and that linebacker. Because I think To'o is their third guy. Like, he was running with the ones when they were running 4-3 early in the game against Pittsburgh. They gave him, like, the press conference thing today. So they usually don't do that with guys who are bums or who they don't think much of. So I think it's To'o, but they've played Hewitt. Like, they've played Hanson, both Phillips guys. So, yeah, backup linebacker is something that I'm intrigued with. Defensive ends, like, you're going to get Hunter and Will Anderson. So, like, depth behind them, I guess, but I really don't want to see a whole lot of depth behind them because I want to see Danielle Hunter and Will Anderson. So, yeah, I don't think there's a ton of intrigue.
Okay. Leo, I still have a bunch of questions. You know, I want to know what questions you have. Like, to me, Jeremy, I think Lassiter, like I said, when we are naming starters, he's a CB2, right? But we haven't seen him play a single snap. An NFL snap yet.
Sure.
Right?
I think that's more for our eyes, though. You know what I mean? Like, and I'm with you. I want to see him too. But I think it's more for our eyes. Like, it's more for, like, okay, what is our peace of mind with Lassiter being the second corner? I don't think that it's a question that if he's healthy, he is the second corner.
Fair. Leo, what are your thoughts? Do you have concerns on what you want to see solidified in terms of the concerns you have about the team? What are you going to be looking for as we watch this Giants game?
Yeah, I want to see our front, our offensive line against their defensive line, because this is the, like, I mean, I don't know how I, like, I like Deontay Banks coming out of school, and I like Drew Phillips, he's a rookie, but specifically their defensive line versus our offensive line, because this is the type of team that I think is kind of built to give us problems when it comes to like the finesse kind of pass blocking line that we have, especially when you think about the tackles. I think that if Dexter Lawrence plays for however many little snaps it is, I need to see Dexter Lawrence versus Scruggs. I need to see Dexter Lawrence versus Scruggs and Kenyon Green, because that is going to kind of show us, you know, what some of these tough games are going to look like versus a team like the Ravens, versus a team like, you know, all those teams that have really physical and big fronts. And I think other than that, I mean, cap battles, like, you know, it kind of is what it is. I'd like to see, you know, Damian Pierce play well. You know, I guess if the line is blocking well, then we'll really get to see exactly who the issue is. I don't think that he's like a perfect zone fit. But, I mean, at the same time, it's like if they do block it up well and you're still looking bad, then there we go, right? And same for Jawar Jordan. And but yeah, man, I mean, outside of that, that's what I'm looking most for. I like to see Mechie kind of get to do more, like, short intermediate routes rather than running the defense off. And then, like, you know, if he's not able to do that, then I guess, well, there you go about that too. But I mean, you know, that's kind of what I would like to see. But even the stuff about the running backs and the receivers, like in the depth chart, I think that's kind of going to be more so about what the Texans want to do as a team. Because like I was saying, I think in our post game, you know, man, there's reasons that you would take Ben Skronik over both Mechie, Robert Woods, and even Hutchinson. You know, because of his versatility to play H-back, you know, because of his versatility to play fullback, his ability to seal the edge at, you know what I'm saying, blocking. Like, he literally damn near is like a tight end when it comes to blocking and stuff. He's that versatile. So I think to a certain point, if it's really even, it's going to come down to exactly what the Texans want to do, you know what I'm saying, from a stylistic standpoint. And then at that point, it's like, do they want to keep a fullback? Do they want to keep a fourth running back? Those are really, really fine details that we just never will know looking from the outside in, you know? So, but yeah, that's how I'm kind of looking at it, you know?
That's fair. Bab is saying, I mean, we need to see if Titus can play against their edges and if he can look like an RT. And then he goes on to say, if Fisher starts and plays well, it's time to have that conversation. Well, before you had the second comment, Bab, what I was going to say is that if Titus is not playing well, because he has been injured, he's obviously back at practice, but he has been injured. If he can't play well, you have Blake Fisher, and then you also have Nick Broeker. So it's not like we don't have any solutions there. As far as having that conversation, he's still a huge dead cap, and Nick Caserio loves him. And so he's not going anywhere. When you got the love of the GM, your place is solidified, as far as I'm concerned. Brandon says, Giants defense were bottom six in yards per game last year. I know that was true, Brandon, but their offense was so terrible, you almost can't even talk about their defense, because the offense basically was three and out almost every single time. It was dog poop. I mean, like, seriously.
And they have one of the best they have the best nose tackle in the NFL. Dexter Lawrence is the best nose tackle in the NFL. So, you know, even if the numbers look bad, it's still going to be a test to see us go against that. And then they added Brian Burns. So, you know, that's a pretty serious. I'm not the biggest KT guy, but I think KT along the Avengers is pretty damn good.
Well, KT is your third guy on the defensive line, though.
That's crazy.
Yeah. I mean, listen, they're kind of stacked, honestly, as far as the defensive line is concerned. So we also want to talk about the players from bubble. We did mention them a little bit here, right? Damian Pierce. What's going on with him? He's got a yard. He's averaging a yard per carry. Xavier Hutchinson, I don't know. I mean, he flashed in one game and then missed every single one, the other one. I've been a big Xavier Hutchinson fan, so I got to let my bias be known. Like, I'm a huge Xavier Hutchinson fan. I think he's going to make this team. I thought that he would possibly have a much bigger role last year. He did not. John Mechie, is he on the bubble? He hasn't really shown out anything yet. We had this big debate in the postgame with Josh Enlio, and I was kind of saying, I could see John Mechie not being on this team. I know that he's got the potential on the upside, but at the end of the day, he's got to show it. You know, he's got to show it on the field. And then you got Ben Skoranek, who had a great first preseason game and then missed everything in it, basically in his second preseason game. But he had an amazing catch that first preseason game. That was probably the best catch of the game. So these are players that are on the bubble, and partly because, first of all, we have probably one of the deepest, not probably, the deepest receiving core in the league, in my opinion. And so there's going to be a lot of players here. You know, Hutchinson, if he doesn't stay here, could go out to another team and have significant reps. So as far as players on the bubble, Jeremy, I'm going to start with you. Who's on the bubble that you want to see out here, and who do you think shouldn't be on the bubble that I'm talking about?
Yeah, I wouldn't put Pierce on the bubble, even though he hasn't played well. And I do have serious questions, like Leo does, with his fit in his own scheme. Like, it wasn't good last year. And, you know, again, small, very few carries in that previous game, but he looks great in training camp, and then he's slow to get to his cuts and his reads. So I still don't think he's on the bubble, though. I just don't think there's running back that's, you know, the talent that's there. Receiving, I don't have Mechie on this team. I put together my 53, and I don't see a path for Mechie to be on this team. And I even hid Noah Brown on my PUP, which I don't even know if that's realistic. Like, I'm hoping they can keep Noah Brown and put him on, you know, on PUP to start the year. That way you can keep an extra body because he doesn't take a spot on the 53, and then you can get him back 4 weeks into the year, 5 weeks in. Well, you have to sit for 4 weeks, so it'd be week five. And then you make a decision there, or maybe you have an injury where he could just naturally take that guy's spot. So I really want them to hide a receiver on PUP. Find a way to hide a receiver on PUP, so you're really keeping seven, but you're only keeping six. I think they're keeping six receivers. I'm with Leo on, like, that six guy kind of depends on more, like, what do they want? What role do they want the guy to fill? Whether I have Skowronek as my sixth guy because of his versatility, like Leo was saying, but what if it's Sims? Like, what if they're like, oh, we love the Sims' versatility in terms of the return game. We like him much better than he was last year. You know, catching the football, he had a touchdown in the postseason. So, like, maybe Sims is the special teams ace that they favor over Skowronek. I don't know. I personally think it's Skowronek, but it wouldn't shock me if it's Sims. So you got Collins, you got Diggs, you got Tank. The way that they're using Robert Woods tells me they like Robert Woods. Like, he didn't play in the first game, which is a pretty good tell that they don't want to play him because they're counting on him. He only played with the ones during the game against the Steelers, and then he was out of his pads by halftime. So they're kind of that to me is a big clue that Robert Woods is on this football team. I'd be surprised if he wasn't based on that alone. I thought he'd be a cut, save the $5 million, no problem there, but it doesn't look like that. So Woods I have on this team. I have Hutch ahead of Mechie. So Hutch is my five, Skowronek's my six. I don't have Mechie on this football team right now unless there's injuries that happen or he just goes nuts over the final few weeks of camp.
Yeah. I mean, listen, I agree. I think Leo has a different perspective. So Leo, what's your thoughts on it?
Man, I'm kind of looking at – I just remember how stagnant the offense would get with Beck on the field sometimes. And I looked at – we swapped picks for a receiver H-back hybrid. And I just can't help but wonder if there is a way that – like, one of the ways they could keep six or seven or an extra receiver simply is just by cutting Brevin Jordan or Beck. You know, one of these tight ends that ain't – that. You know, or like, because my thing is Beck technically was or has experience playing tight end. You look at, you know, the fullbacks and the, you look at the fullbacks and that, like, that are kind of used around the Shanahan tree in general. They have tight end experience. So my thing is, like, maybe they, like Ingold is plays snaps in line. You know, Kyle Juszczyk plays significant snaps in line to the point where I don't know who the 49ers third tight end is off the top of my head, nor do I know the third tight end on the Dolphins off the top of my head. So I'm wondering, man, like, is there any significance to that pick swap, you know?
Yeah.
And I like, because the thing that I saw clearly last year was based on how our team is built with the front, with the line and all that stuff, we are just better right now out of 11 personnel. So I wonder, like, if and we're so deep at receiver, I wonder, like, would you rather be patient with some of these young receivers and get Beck out of there or one of those guys out of there, you know what I mean? The more time, you know, like, that's something I think that can happen rather than just cutting one of these dudes. And like I think it would be more advantageous just to probably trade one. And then I think like trading one of those guys, man, like could look stupid in like 2 years. You know what I mean? Like, so I don't know, man. But at the same time, like I think Pierce, I do think we need to see some of Pierce. I want to say they ran some power stuff with them too, and it still wasn't working. So I don't know, man. It's tough. I do want to see Mechie. I do think like, and this I'll finish with this. I do feel like Woods and Xavier Hutchinson did get a lot of like routes that were like kind of like short, kind of easy. I don't want to say easy throws, but they weren't running off the defense like I think Mechie was. I would like to see Mechie kind of run more like short routes and get easier, just line of sight throws for the quarterback, catch the ball and see if he could get upfield and make someone miss. And then I think, like I said, like if he looks significantly worse than Hutchinson doing that, you know what I'm saying? It is what it is, you know? But it's, you know, I just haven't seen enough for me personally, you know, to say clearly that I think he's off the team, you know?
Yeah, I had that same thought with Skowronek when they traded for him. But I feel like we would see him running with the ones a little bit if that was one of their plans. And maybe I'm reading way too much into like preseason and training camp depth charts, which, I mean, sometimes it doesn't matter at all. But I think we would see it a little bit more, because I had that same thought that maybe we see Skowronek. You know, a lot of teams don't even carry a fullback. Now, Shanahan trees do, but they are hybrids. So like I had that same thought, but I feel like we would have seen them a little bit more. I feel like we would have seen that. But maybe they're hiding it, you know? Maybe that's one of those things that they don't want anybody to know and they're hiding it.
Yeah, I mean, that could totally be the case. I mean, my feeling right now is Dameon Pierce right now, he's cheap, right? Because he was a fourth-round pick, is $1.2 million. The question to me is that, is he still worthy to be an RB4 if they keep four running backs? Now, when it comes to special teams, I feel like he could be a good gunner. I think he could be a good returner. But now you have Steven Sims. So that's a debate there, because Steven Sims and Dameon Pierce doesn't even count against the 51. That's how little he gets paid, right? So, you know, if they're right now we have $20 million, though. So I don't know if they're planning to do something. Now, if they got Justin Simmons or something, then that conversation will be a lot more relevant. And then I think, you know, you have that cap discussion. When it comes to Xavier Hutchinson, one of the reasons is not necessarily the fact of just his receiving ability, but the biggest runs we got are from his jet sweeps. So they may want to keep him on to get the 10 yards, out of a jet sweep. I mean, he's been pretty successful doing that. Now, I understand as far as a receiver, he's not the best route runner, but he does have the best hands. When he was out of college, he had the best hands in the draft, literally with something like 4% drop rate. Right. And one of the challenges I'm having with John Mechie is not his route running ability, because he's an amazing route runner, both in camp and in what I saw. Right. The issue in preseason games, the issue is he just can't catch, it looks like. Right. I like rub that stickum on there, put it on, you know, just lather it. I mean, he just can't catch. That's my problem with Mechie. And with Ben Skowronek, it's you flash once and then the next game you look terrible. So is there a consistency problem? As far as the fullback conversation, I messaged that I am all about Beck. I am Beck's number one hater. All right, I'll tell you that right now. remember the whole, if you guys remember, there was the whole thing with Scott Quisenberry where I was Scott Quisenberry's number one hater, and I really don't think Beck provides all that much. When he is blocking up front, he's a slow blocker. I think that's also part of the reason why Dameon Pierce doesn't look good, because they tell him to run behind Beck a lot. And Beck is so slow that Dameon Pierce doesn't have the patience to wait behind him blocking and literally runs in front of him. It runs in front of his blocker and obviously can't get any yards that way. And I feel like what does Beck do? He's not a receiving threat and he's not the best blocker. So what does he do for this team? I don't see it. So to me, he's dead weight. I'd rather, you know, you could put Skowronek there. You could put Tor Hairston back there. There's a lot of different options. I just don't see what Beck provides to this team. I don't know. I don't think he gets cut, but I'm going to go on record and say that I'm a big Beck hater. do either of you have any thoughts on Beck?
I don't think he's a great fullback. I think it's more they're going to keep a fullback. Like, why is he on the roster? Is it because he's a great fullback, or is it because they want a fullback? I think it's because they want a fullback.
Yeah.
I think, yeah, man. I mean, bro, we will tell you, man, like, the first, like, 8 weeks of the season almost, I was screaming that stuff. Like, I was like, man, it just, like, they keep trying to, like, it's like they kept trying to, like, force us to be San Francisco. And then we would go down in games. And then next thing you know, like, we're throwing the ball and we're spreading teams out. And we're just working. And, you know, I can't explain it. You know, I think that we just got to just kind of move on from that. And maybe, like, as we, like, maybe, you know, Shaq Mason, you know, he retires next year. We end up getting another guard, a bigger, more physical guard. And then it works better. You know what I'm saying? Maybe Blake Fisher turns out to be Lane Johnson or some shit, and then we end up it works better. But the thing is like, we, there's no kind of deception that we can, when we come out in heavy sets, there's not that much deception, because you can kind of still bracket. The problem is, I saw, is you could basically play too high against us in like 12 personnel, and they, you can still stop the run, which is kind of, and then on top of that, we can't pass out of it because then you, at that point, you have like three receiving threats. Because in Schultz, to me, Schultz is kind of like a guy that is kind of dependent on having like three other guys that kind of force and dictate covers. And then he kind of finds an open spot. I don't think he's like a guy that really just can cook anyone in front of him. So,
yeah,
you know, that doesn't mean he's not a great player, you know, but it's just, he's not the most explosive tight end in the league, you know.
He's just not top tier. He's not Kelsey. He's not McBride. He's good. He's not elite. Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm strong on that.
And that's kind of how I look at it. So it wouldn't shock me, but I know D'Amico. I feel like D'Amico. I told V, it was either V or Josh. I told him, I was like, he's like the smartest meathead you ever meet. You know what I'm saying? I don't think that he will ever. It's like you said, like, I think he wants to be able to play 4-3. I think he wants to be able to have a fullback and run the ball 40 times and make people, you know, just make people submit. But as of right now, we just haven't been able to do it out of those looks, you know. So.
Yeah, I think it's more Slowick with the fullback, at least. I think that, you know, you look at the Shanahan tree, they love fullbacks. Like,
they love fullbacks.
They like to motion them. They like to move them around. They call it, what do they call it, diversity of look or something. Oh, something weird, like something way over my head. I don't know if y'all listen to that. What is it, Play Callers?
The podcast on the Athletic.
I love listening to that.
That's crazy.
That's great. It's really good. It kind of opens your mind on things. They had Gerard on there. Gerard Johnson was on there. They had like a special bonus one I was listening to the other day, but he was talking a little bit about like their language, and it's like, yeah, diversity of offensive look. And they used a real fancy word. I'm like, okay, this stuff's way over my head. What do y'all think? Like, because you bring up the Pierce being cheap, I think that's why his roster spot is safe, is because he's cheap. But I wonder too, like, from looking at the contract status and just looking at like who's under contract, not this year, but like going forward, if that's one of the things that I don't think anybody's talking about, is that if Xavier Hutchinson and John Mechie are tied, let's say it comes down to Mechie versus Hutchinson. Hutchinson's a little cheaper because he was late sixth round pick. Mechie was a second round pick. But Mechie only has 2 years left on his deal. Like, Hutchinson has a year longer on his contract. So if it's a tie, wouldn't you choose the cheaper option that is also has an extra year of club control? Like, I think that's something that hasn't really been brought up that I think could break a tie between those two guys.
Yeah, I think so. Also, you know, Mechie has unfortunate injury history. And I'm not just talking about the cancer now. I'm talking about the hamstring, the ACL, et cetera. So that's got to be factored in as well. I think there's plenty of avenues right here why he's on the bubble. We'll see against the Giants if we all change our tune, right? But so far, I haven't seen a single game from Mechie in preseason that I can say, yup, he's making the team. But I wanted to move on to the AFC South, because we've now seen the Jaguars, the Titans, and the Colts play. And I want to see if your thoughts, I know that, Jeremy, you actually talked about this on your show a little bit today. So let's talk about that a bit.
In the city of Duval where the Jaguars play, they talk big game, but they can't slay. Glitter kitties on the field, no fire in their eyes. They're a park, no bike, full of empty lies. In the land of steel where the weak attack.
So the Jaguars and the Chiefs played, and in the beginning, the Jaguars' defense struggled. They really didn't stop the Chiefs' offense. The Chiefs was able to basically do whatever the hell they wanted to do. The biggest play you really saw there was Parker Washington, that 73rd return kickoff. You obviously had the Bryant Thomas catch, that 41-yarder throw. But the Jaguars were able to run the ball overall, way better than we were able to, by the way. You know, 4.1 yards per carry, 102 yards overall. The Chiefs did screw up the rules and scored a safety. They didn't score a safety, but they caused a safety. And so basically, they didn't understand the new kickoff rules, and they thought it was going to be a touchback, but no, that's a safety. They had another play was the Jags quarterback, Christian Braswell. They had a strip sack. It would have been returned for a touchdown, but they called it back. That's arguable whether the ref was correct. Overall, Trevor Lawrence was 3-for-4, 42 yards, one touchdown pass, rated 147.9 quarterback rating. He took a sack. And like I said, you had that Brian Thomas play, two targets, one catch, 41 yards. Question to you, Jeremy, is have your thoughts about the Chiefs changed at all by seeing what you saw at during this preseason game?
The Chiefs? No. No.
I'm sorry, the Jaguars. I'm sorry. Okay. I meant to say.
No. I put very little stock in preseason games. Like, I like to look at it from player performance. I like to look at it from depth chart perspective, but again, that's more selfishly for, like, fantasy. Like, is Brian Thomas, what volume is Brian Thomas looking like? Is he the clear-cut number two, number one? So I have a very difficult time looking at it from a performance base. Because, I mean, a lot of times the defenses are so vanilla. They're not showing you anything. You go back to the Hall of Fame game against the Bears and Slowick's like, yeah, we play these guys early in the year. We're not giving them any looks. You had some, like Davis Mills was talking post game. Yeah, we play them early in the year. We're doing very basic stuff. So like you're trying to win, but the motive isn't necessarily winning. You know, like it's about let's give these guys this many plays. Let's get them ready for the season. Like winning a preseason game is like there's 18 different things that are more important. So it's tough for me to put a whole lot of value in the wins and losses. It's hard for me to put a ton of value in the performance. You see some guys that are just preseason heroes, and they put up huge numbers, and then you get to the season, they don't even play. So it's kind of one of those things where over the years I've really tried to ignore it, but I do like to see who's running with the ones, what does the volume look like. But again, that's more from a fantasy perspective.
Okay. One thing I forgot to mention real quick is the Jaguars ended up having 5 sacks throughout that preseason game. Did that matter to you at all?
I think that matters some. I think that matters more than, like, the Trevor Lawrence stuff because, I mean, these teams are trying to get rid of the football. Like, they don't want to get their quarterback hit. I'm curious how many of those fast 5 sacks were when Mahomes was in the game. You know, I'd be curious about that because, if you know, Carson Wentz is their backup, and they probably even got to their 3rd and 4th string. I don't even know who is taking snaps 3rd and 4th string for the Chiefs. That matters, but I wonder how many were the ones. You know, if they had 4 of their 5 sacks were their backups, okay, that doesn't carry a whole lot of weight with me.
All right. Leo, what about you? Did your perspective on where you had the Chiefs change at all after witnessing this preseason game?
The Chiefs or the Jags? You mean the Chiefs? You mean
both? I don't know why I keep saying that.
Oh, no, you're good. The Jags, man, you know, I think I'm a little bit higher on the whole division than I think most people are. I think their front is going to be very good, you know, depending on – I think if those two young defensive tackles they got can come on at any point in the season, and if Eric Armstead is healthy for, you know, a large portion of the season, I think they can have one of the better fronts in the NFL. I think the acquisition of Darnell Savage, you know, and playing him in the slot, which he hasn't really ever played before, and then the two linebackers that they have, I think their front is going to be very, like, difficult to deal with. So, to me, it's not – and I think that their goal is really going to be just having enough production on offense to kind of just win. You know what I'm saying? Like, they're not trying – I don't think they're trying to come out and put, like, 40 points on people to win. I think they're literally just trying to do enough, you know. And, you know, they could be a really annoying team to play, and then you go back and look at them on paper and be like, how the hell did we lose to them? And it's like, well, right, they're just physical as hell, you know, and they're just, you know, annoying as, you know – I almost slipped up.
You caught yourself.
I've been doing good. but that's it.
All right, let's talk about the Colts. All right, so the Colts and Broncos game. So what did we witness? Well, we saw the Colts scored 4 touchdowns but still lost. Obviously, losses and wins don't matter, but it was just interesting that they scored 4 touchdowns and still lost. Anthony Richardson had 1 first down. It was a 19-yard catch and run. It wasn't a full 19-yard pass. It was a catch and run to Mo'Ali Cox. That's basically the only real play that mattered for him. Kenny Moore must be the luckiest corner in the league. I mean, last year when he was playing against the Panthers, he had easy interceptions. Now, again, if you saw the highlight, even if you didn't see the game, it was off a drop, tipped off the hand, was able to get the interception. This guy just falls into opportunity every single time. So he had an interception off the drop. Mm-hmm. Anthony Richardson, 2 for 4, 50% overall, 25 yards. Beyond this, there's a question that Kate Adams asked, and I want to know what your guys' thoughts are on it.
I want this to be the best rivalry in the NFL. Mm-hmm. Can you tell me, or do you consider it a top rivalry? Is it real? You were part of some big ones in San Francisco, of course. How real is this rivalry? What is there?
No, I definitely think there's some bad blood between the two teams, for sure. You know what I mean? Especially, CJ's been talking a little bit in the offseason. Zaire's been talking a little bit in the offseason. And, you know, at the end of the day, we split. You know what I mean? We won the first one, they won the second one. Obviously, the second one was bigger to get them to the playoffs. And there's definitely some bad blood in the water. So, it's definitely one of those rivalries you got to look out
for. So the question is, one, did your thoughts about the Colts change at all? And number two, do we actually have our worst rivalry with the Colts, or did I say best, whatever your perception is? Those are the two questions. Jeremy, what are your thoughts?
This is a game that I actually watched for a good chunk because I wanted to see what Anthony Richardson looks like. And I see David in the chat, if preseason is not important, then why play? I don't think anybody said it wasn't important. We said the win was not important. I think preseason is vitally important because you're talking about guys making the team. You're talking about who's going to be starting for your teams if there are starting position battles. I take things that are tangible in the preseason that then can be applied in the regular season. That's why I don't care a whole lot about watching threes or fours, although they are factors in making the roster. Now, watching Anthony Richardson, I thought he was incredibly inaccurate. Like the first series of the game is third and whatever. I don't even know who the intended receiver was, but the guy was open. He was running like a 6-7 yard out. Maybe it was a 3rd and 10. And if he hits him in stride, easy catch and run for a first down, maybe even a chunk play. It could be 15, 20 yards pretty easily. Throws it behind him, and it still might have been completed, so it doesn't look like it was inaccurate because it's a completed pass. But he had it to the intended target, has to turn around, make the catch, gets hit immediately, shy of the sticks. Like, those little things carry tons of weight, and if you're just looking at a box score, you're like, well, he completed a pass for 7 yards. That looks all right. So the inaccuracy there, it's like, okay, how accurate is this guy going to be? There was one of his knocks coming into the NFL. I thought he looked good early last year, quite frankly. Through the interception late in the game, I think that was the pass that was deflected. Was that the deflected pass that Richardson threw for the pick?
Honestly, I can't remember.
It might have been. I think he threw a pick in that game. If not, it was like a dropped interception. But, I'm concerned about his inaccuracy. Okay, it was dropped interception. And the Colts aren't going to, like, and this is where, like, preseason, regular season are different. Because, like, preseason, okay, Anthony Richardson, throw the ball a good amount of times, throwing behind receivers, that means you're short of the change as opposed to moving the chains. Regular season, they're going to be running it a ton. Like, Colts want to lead the league in rushing yardage at the end of the year. And they have the pieces that can do that with Taylor. And, you know, Anthony Richardson is going to be a huge factor in the run game, too. But if Anthony Richardson is forced to beat teams with the arm, I think they can struggle. Now, I think they're good enough with the running element on the defensive side of the ball that they'll compete for the division and have a winning record. But the key to beat the Colts is going to force Anthony Richardson to throw the football. And maybe he improves. Like, I'm sure he's rusty. Like, he hadn't played in a while, didn't play a whole lot. It's only his second year, and he's incredibly talented and athletic. The rivalry thing, like, yeah, let's have a rivalry. I think it is fun. And I think it is the biggest rivalry the Texans will have, because they had the games with stakes last year. I think what leads to rivalries are games with stakes. You know, okay, you could say, you know, if you're the Titans, you know, the Titans and the Texans have the whole history, and they have the Oiler, you know, jerseys, and nobody likes Amy Adams dunk. So we get all of that. But if the Titans are 4-13 or 4-12, you're playing them in week 17 and you're resting starters because you've clinched a spot in the AFC, you know, a bye or whatever, or you're just locked in like a 3 seed, that game doesn't really have a whole lot of juice. So, like, how do you build the bad blood? How do you build the rivalry? You do that with high-stake games that matter. And I think you're going to see a lot of that with the Texans and the Colts over the years. So I do think it's real.
Okay. Leo, let me know your thoughts on the game, and do we have a real rivalry with the Colts?
I'm going to just say I think they're the most overrated team in the NFL. The only thing that I enjoy watching, you know, in that game was Liatu Latu, who I think is the best player on their defense. I think they've been wasting Alec Pierce with mediocre quarterback play. You know, I think their offensive line is overrated. I think their quarterback is Bo Jackson with a cannon for an arm. And I mean, I'm just tired of everybody talking about how much they are going to make a run against us. I hate the Colts. I hate the blue that they wear. I hate that stupid horseshoe on their hat. You know what I'm saying? I hate Jonathan Taylor for wearing that guardian cap on his head. I mean, what else? I hate DeForest Buckner for saying that weak stuff that he just said, bro. Like, it's like, man, like, stop being – like, dog, listen, bro. We split, yes, but when everything was on the line, we won. You know what I'm saying? With the season, we ended the Colts season. I'm tired of hearing about them. Why am I always hearing about the Colts, bro? They're saying we're going to win a division. I'm tired. And Jeremy, you brought up a good point, the run game.
Yeah.
Another good point. Anthony Richardson. He has to prove that he can stay healthy playing that style of football. And I love him as a player and a prospect. He seems like a phenomenal person, but he hasn't been healthy doing it. And, you know, that's it. You know what I mean? I'm not scared of him. I think that if we put some points on him, I think we'll just see. You know, we'll see how willing they are to stick to the run and all of that. But I'm also not impressed with their defensive depth. You know, I hate their second defensive line. I hate their second linebackers. You know, I hate all of their corners. No, I mean,
he's already dead.
I mean, I think that they're the most overrated team in football. Yeah, I mean, I'm sorry, I have to say this. People keep on talking about the fact that we benefited from a hurt division. They benefited from a hurt and weak division too. Like, yeah, all people. Listen, bro. I'm sorry, I'm going all the way in, bro. The only reason they had a chance to play to get to the playoffs is because the Jags lost. Like, we was gonna, like, you know what I'm saying? Like, come on, bro.
Yep.
I hate this talk. Everywhere I go, it's the Colts are gonna win the AFC South this year, and I'm just tired of it. So I keep going, but I'm choose to stop.
Preach. I'm here for it. All right, so let's get to the last team here that I don't think it's really gonna matter all that much for us this year, but
last season, y'all was straight trash. Oh, what a display with that QB sipping mayo like it's gourmet. But you end up last place. Ain't nothing more to say. Derrick Henry, he left. Now y'all got no power. Your offense needs some help. It's looking real sour.
All right. So the Titans versus the 49ers. Now, in the beginning, not just the beginning, but overall their defense wasn't great. But they didn't have Jeffrey Simmons, Harold Landry, Legarius Sneed, Chidobe Awuzie, Quandre Diggs, none of them were playing. You can't really judge their defense, but it didn't look all that great. Will Levis went 4 out of 5 for 35 yards, a rushing TD. He left the field with a 14-7 lead, a decent performance from him. Honestly, better performance than AR, that's for sure. So the question is, has your opinion of them changed because Will Levis looks like, I know it's only 5 passes and, you know, it's not that much, but has your opinion changed of the Titans at all, at least from the offensive side, because we really didn't see the defense out there, Jeremy?
No, not really. I think they're the bottom of the division, and I probably like Levis more than most people. I think he's talented. I think he has.
Have you met Leo?
I didn't know that Leo was a Levis guy. No, I was a fan of his coming out of Kentucky. I thought he needed a few years before he really hits his stride because he's raw. I think he's pretty raw. But he's got a huge arm. He's super athletic. He's fast. He's faster than people think. He can bulldoze you too. Like he's a big dude, and I think he has the potential to be accurate. It's kind of why I think the Titans made a good decision moving off of Vrabel. It's like, well, why'd they move on from Vrabel? They've overachieved, and that stuff is true. And I think Vrabel can be a good head coach. I think he has been a good head coach. But you have a second year quarterback that needs to be groomed and developed. If you don't have a good quarterback in the NFL, you have no chance. It seems like. So you bring in Callahan, who was very instrumental in the grooming of Burrow, and it's like, okay, well, this team is totally changing its philosophy. Like, you're going defensive-minded, muck it up, win ugly games, to now you're bringing in Callahan, and you want to be, like, this beautiful offense. So I thought it was a good move because they needed to develop Levis, but I think it's a transitional team. I think it's a team that, you know, they might surprise you, but surprise might be, like, 6 wins. I'm curious about the direction they go with Callahan, but I think they're the bottom team of the AFC South. I think it's a rebuild transition year for them.
Okay. Leo, what are your thoughts?
I think it just comes down to how their O-line blocks. And I think that if their O-line blocks well, I think they will challenge us for the division, like along with the Jacksonville Jaguars. And I think that the Colts will be the last team in the division for all the reasons that I just explained. But, you know, I think it just comes down to him getting blocking, something that he hasn't had like since his first year at Kentucky.
Yeah.
I think that their defense, man, if their defense is healthy, I think that it's kind of going to be too good for them to only win 5 or 6 games, you know, because this is the first time that Simmons is going to be playing next to a guy that is a guy that is going to command double teams every play. And I think that with that secondary, man, the way that they're going to be able to kind of suffocate teams on the outside and then just the pressure that they'll be able to create in the center of the pocket, you know, it's going to be hell on earth for a lot of teams, you know. So I think, like, there are another team that I think is kind of built in a way that could be annoying for us to play. Not saying that we'll lose to the Titans, but I do think, and when I say us, I mean just every team in general, you know. And I think they'll be like really good, you know. And they also had the DC from Baltimore. Their DC is from Baltimore, so they're kind of running, I think, kind of that hybrid kind of multiple front defense. So I mean, you know, I think they'll be better than a lot of people. But I think our division is gonna be like on some stuff like the worst. As much as I talk stuff about the Colts, I think they'll get 7 wins. I think they'll get 6 wins or something like that. And I think it'll be just as competitive as it was between the top 3 teams in the division like it was last year, you know? So that's how I look at it.
All right. Speaking of the Titans, Bustle with the Boys came up with the new proposal for uniform rules on who can wear the Oilers uniforms. Now, basically what they're saying is kind of treat it where whoever wins the last game, so it's obviously we play the Titans twice, whoever wins that last game against each other gets to wear it for the entire year. I don't really buy that rule because, especially with the way that the NFL makes it up, we may not play starters sometimes against them in the last game because if they're, you know, week 18 or whatever, and we may not care about that. So I don't like that rule. I'm curious, what would your proposed rule be in order to who is able to wear the Oilers uniform? Jeremy, what do you think?
I think I'm over this. Like, and I am a diehard Oiler. Like, I have Oiler merch. I have the old Oiler hats. I have Oiler shirts. I have Oiler iced tea glasses. I went to the Astrodome as a kid and watched the Oilers. I remember watching Warren Moon there. I remember going there the final year they were in Houston. So, like, I have a lot of love for the Oilers, and Love You Blue is real. Like, I was ingrained with that. I was conditioned with that. But I think it's done. You know, I think it's something that we look back in nostalgia, especially with the new gear. You know, like we got new threads now. Like why do we want to wear the Oilers stuff now? And I like those. Like I hate that Tennessee wears them, but I hate more that they wear them than I wish the Texans would wear them. Like to me, it's two separate entities. It's the Oilers, the team that used to be here that you love, and now it's the Texans who are new, different entity entirely. Now I do hate that the Oilers wear them. So if they did like go through this proposal, hypothetical proposal, like I would just want to take it away from them. Not that I would ever want to wear them. So that would, yeah, that's kind of my viewpoint on it. I don't need the Oiler uniforms, the IP back. I would like the history though, especially like honoring the players, you know, like Warren Moon being honored at halftime. That should be done. Bruce Matthews, you know, that should be done. You know, it should be the Houston history. It's so weird to me that they bring out these iconic Houston football players to Nashville and like, hey, this is our ring of, like, no, Nashville doesn't know them. Nashville doesn't love them like Houston loves them. So that's my biggest regret with the whole history. The uniform stuff, like I'm over this, and I infamously once said that I would trade Deshaun Watson for the Oilers, you know, IP. kind of tongue-in-cheek, people ran with that. But I think I'm past it. It does trigger me when they wear them, though. I will say that.
Okay. Leo, thoughts on the uniforms? How would you propose any new rule?
Yeah, Jeremy brought up a really good point again about the history. I think that is something that I wish. It's really selfish that they did that. You know what I mean? That's really just crazy. But yeah, man, just thinking about this, and as y'all was talking, it just made me realize that between DeForest Buckner and between listening to Nico and Tank, I think that this young generation of just athletes in general just don't know how to hate properly. Because I think that, you know what I'm saying, he doesn't, you know, he's acting soft about the rivalry thing. Tank and Nico are acting, you know, professional. I'll say they're very professional. But, you know, I think it's time that we just say, screw that, man. You know, let's just beat the living shit out of them every time they play in them, to the point where it's just like, dang, bro. Like, you know, so, you know. Like, it should be that level of hate, man, you know? But maybe I'm just mentally disturbed or something.
But I'm with you, man. I'm with you, man. You know. I'm with you. All right, so absolute last thing we're going to talk about today, because we're already a couple minutes over. So Will Levis put out, not just Will Levis, but Hellman's put this out. I'm curious what your thoughts are.
They try to define you, but you are the ingredient to your own success. Luscious, eggy, smell like greatness.
Will Levis, number 8, Parfum de Mayonnaise.
All right. So the question really is this brilliant or is this dumb? Jeremy, you're first.
Parfum. I've never heard it pronounced that with parfum. Both, right? I think it's both. Like, how can you watch that commercial and then say it's not dumb? You know, like, was that bread toasted? I hope it was. Like, was it untoasted bread with that mayonnaise on it? I don't
it
like
it. Not toasted.
It looked untoasted. It looked a little limp. It looked a little soft. I don't like the Titans, right? No, I mean, it's dumb. I mean, how could you watch that and not say dumb? Like, you got some Zoolander vibes, I think. Like, yes, it is dumb. But we're all talking about Hellman's today. Everybody is talking about Hellman's today. So the dumb factor of it leads to its brilliance, right? I think it's a fine line between dumb and brilliant. Yes, the commercial is dumb. But it is also brilliant because we're all talking about Hellman's mayonnaise on August 13th when we would never be talking about the Hellman's mayonnaise.
Yeah,
I kind of have to agree. Leo, what are your thoughts on the commercial?
Yeah, man, you know, I don't eat mayonnaise. I probably have never ate mayonnaise in my life. Being the resident black man of the show, you know, I've never eaten I'm just playing. I'm joking. But no, like, you know, so I guess, you know, you're right. I barely knew what Hellman's was until literally 5 seconds ago. So, hey, man, you know, shout out to Will Levis, man. And who would have thought just, you know, that one stupid TikTok would have turned into a legit, endorsement. So
right.
You know, I guess shout outs to him, man. You know, I mean, also V, never play any kind of video like that on this podcast again. I'll say that too. But yeah.
Curse of Dennis Allen. We don't have time to get to that, but you know what? I'm going to use that question. I'll put and subscribe to the channel. We'll talk about it next week. I have to tell you what I think about this Will Levis commercial. Absolutely brilliant, man. Absolutely brilliant. I don't care what you think about Will Levis, and I don't care what you think about helmets. I delve into marketing. I do that. That's actually what my real job is I do marketing for small companies. And I have to say, everyone's talking about it, right? I mean, and people are buying it. It's $8. So you could buy. So the cool thing is they didn't make this like $80 or something. You can buy this right now for $8. There's already pics of people that have already prepaid apparently and got this. And the bottle looks like it was made by Dior or something. And I just think it's brilliant because even if you don't like Hellman's, you are talking about it. Leo, you're talking about it. And I got to say, this endorsement is obviously helping Will Levis financially. He's a rookie. He's getting paid at a rookie scale, not even a first rounder. So it's helping him. It's helping Hellman's. And I guarantee you, everyone in the organization is laughing their butt off on this as well. So I got to hand it to Hellman's and hand it to Will Levis. As much as I hate the Titans, good job. Good job. I got to say, it's brilliant. With that being said, I want to thank you all for watching the show and ask you guys to visit Texans22.com. When you visit Texans22.com, you can get t-shirts. They start at $19.99. You can get a vest. This is the Nick Caserio vest. That actually was on Kate Adams. He actually saw the vest and talked about it. We have that clip on the YouTube channel. Go just search for Texans22 on YouTube if you want to check that out. You can get all sorts of shirts. You can get hats. You can get water bottles. You can get all sorts of stuff. It's the best way to support the channel. If you're not subscribed to the Texans 22 YouTube channel, go ahead and do that. What you're missing out is all the different breakdowns. We just did a breakdown on what on the Hall of Fame stuff, on the Hall of Fame game. We did a breakdown on the All-22 of Daniel Hunter, who looked like an absolute beast. 7 snaps, a sack, a TFL, 3 QB hits. All of that is broken down with the All-22. Leo and Josh do a great job. So check out the YouTube channel if you're on X or if you're on Twitch. Go ahead and check that out on YouTube and support the channel by buying a shirt or something else on Texas22.com. Jimmy, you want to tell any of our subscribers what you guys should be talking about on the radio tomorrow?
Well, lots of Texans. Texans are a hot topic right now. Most anticipated season ever when it comes to the Texans. D'Amico, you know, you have so much belief in him, so much belief in C.J. Stroud. So it's a great time to do radio in Houston with the Texans. And you know, Astros are still winning baseball games too, so they're red hot. So, good time to do sports radio in Houston. It's a lot of fun.
Awesome, awesome. With that being said, I want to thank you guys for sticking with us. I know we went a little long today. Just remember, always, 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 the Texas 22 team always has your back.
Texas 22, breaking it down. Podcast got the city vibing to the sound. Special guests dropping knowledge so true. Keep the Texas down. This one's for you.